Hi, I'm Sam Pang and welcome to ADBC. Tonight, we'll be busting out the dance moves of history as we macarena our way through the scenes from our past. Our two teams will be bus-stopping, moonwalking and nut-bushing across the ancient dance floor of time as they let their knowledge move with the rhythmic music of the questions. Ridiculous. Let's meet them. Our first guest has lectured at Melbourne, Deakin and La Trobe Universities. She has a PhD in history and we'll put it to the test tonight. Please welcome Dr. Emily Booth. Thank you, Emily. Next to Emily is a very funny and talented man. Please welcome Andrew McClellan.
Thank you.
Andrew, first time on the show.
Yes.
If you go back and be anyone in history, who would it be?
Oh, you know, I've been reading a bit of Roman history recently. I think I want to be the son of one of the emperors. Because most of them are mental, so as long as you don't marry a horse or something, you're probably going to be king of the world.
Can you categorically tell us now that you wouldn't marry a horse?
Yes.
Okay, well, to the BC team, she is a professor of international history who in 2006 was appointed a member of the International Scientific Committee for the History of UNESCO. Please welcome Professor Glenda Sluger. And the man next to Glenda has won an ARIA, but was less successful with his recent foray into Aussie hip-hop under the moniker T-Money. And I can tell you that all tickets to the T-Money Ram Jam shows are now refundable. It's comedian Tony Mutton.
Thank you. Everything you say is true as always, Sam. I've actually done time after I popped a cap into Dave Dobbin. Very ugly feud.
Glenda, can you tell us something significant about Australian history that we may not know?
Well, the story I love to tell my students is about the history of Blues Point in Sydney, which was named after a man called Billy Blues. And he came from Africa originally, ended up being dragooned as a slave into the War of Independence in America. And then in England, he was sent as a convict for a minor crime to Australia, where he befriended Governor Macquarie. And Governor Macquarie gave him that land. And he marries and has a huge family, and they're part of the story of the history of Australia.
Emily, can you tell us about one of the sillier moments in history?
One of my favourites involves Charles VIII of France. He had six toes and he had to have special wide shoes made to accommodate the extra toe width. And so because whatever the kings did was the fashion, people in his court started to wear wider and wider toed shoes, and it became common that the wider your shoes were, the more important you were, and people were walking around in kind of flippers in the court until eventually a ruling was made that shoes had to be a bit more foot-shaped, and it all came to an end.
A ruling was made that shoes had to become more foot-shaped.
Yes. That was a big day in Parliament, that one.
It's a big one.
We've got to stop this out now.
OK, let's start the show. Teams will be given clues about the origins of a well-known phrase. All they have to do is identify what the phrase is. Emily and Andrew, you can go first for 10 points. This phrase, originating in Spain, indicates a complete lack of concern or interest in something, or even to have contempt for it.
I'll forget about it.
Well, that's Spanish, isn't it?
I want to give points for the first accent of the night.
We're going to need another clue.
No, I'll give you the Spanish in a minute. For the Spanish, the traditional way to represent contempt for someone was to place the thumb between the index finger and the middle finger. And in Spanish, this is da la higa. No, on the same hand.
Oh.
On the same hand. Yes.
That's got your nose, isn't it?
That old Spanish phrase, got your nose. No, but that is the gesture.
Hey, finger thumb, I don't give a fig for what you say.
It's I don't give a fig.
Whoa! Oh,
well done. This phrase refers to a type of fruit that was considered of little or no value at the time, and the fruit in question is a fig, and the phrase is don't give a fig. All this time, did we think that fig was just a substitute for another word?
Yes, we did.
Yes, we did, didn't we?
And the phrase mother figure? Is that
yeah, that's on another show, Tone. To the BC team. Glenn, here are your clues for 10 points. This is a phrase that relates to appropriating someone else's idea. The theatrical background from the early 1700s.
So to be too early for the word visard to be used.
Yeah.
Stole my thumb.
Here's the answer. 10 points.
Here we early now on this show.
To have originated what they're right, called John Dennis, 769 at Bond.
Classic.
A classic. Dennis had insect for the bait.
Used to know Rolf Harris.
Despite his sword, was used by the show that had stolen his idea. When we went along the theatre, the villains will play my thunder. You can tell why he was a failed playwright. Hardly inspiring.
If it had rhymed, I would have liked it.
This rhymes good. In that round, Emily and Andrew, you picked up 10 points, and Glenda and Tony, you also picked up 10 points. Here's tonight's postcard, and there are some written clues on the back. There's the postcard. But let's look at the back of the postcard for a written clue. On the island of Mare. Buzz in if you think you know the answer. I'll give you some clues. It is in Australia.
I think I had a holiday there.
Is it a Queensland resort where people always go, it wasn't like this in the brochure? Is it one of those?
I think we're really far north. The island of Mare actually has an English name, another name as well, which might be Murray Island?
Yes, it is. This is Murray Island. Well done. 10 points. In the Torres Strait. Question two. What happened here in May 1989? Emily's buzzed in, but I'll give you the written clue on the back first. Don't fence me in.
Well, I thought I knew until I got that clue.
Please put you off.
Wasn't this particular site one of the contested islands in the first Mabo case against the Queensland government?
Second.
Right.
Keep going.
It was the second one for all the people who couldn't get tickets to the first one, if you remember.
Yeah. Yes, it was like State of Origin. It was best of three.
It's where Eddie Mabo came from, yeah?
Yes, that's right. Emily and Andrew, I'll give you 10 points. Well done.
Yes.
Can anyone tell us any more, though? Eddie Mabo, what did he do on this island? Who did he take up there?
So it was the Murray Islanders that contested, took to the court the question of native title, and contested the principle of terra nullius.
And what's terra nullius?
And terra nullius is the legal concept on which the European occupation of Australia was based. The idea that the land was empty, that there was no pre-existing people with any traditions or customs that had to be recognised. So they challenged that in order to lay claim to ownership of Murray Island or Mare Island.
Oh, well done. I'm going to give you 10 points as well. Well done. So Eddie Mabo took the court up to Murray Island, and what did he actually do? If we have a look at this postcard, what was he showing the courts?
A fence?
Yes, he was showing fence, that these were traditional boundaries that had been there for countless generations.
I do know something about Eddie Mabo, that his actual name, and this sounds like a terrible joke, but it's true, was Eddie Sambo.
Really?
That was his original name, and he had it changed to Eddie Mabo, which is just as well, because people would be referring to the Sambo decision to this day. Pauline Hanson, I think, still calls it the Sambo decision. She knows nothing about the name.
Question three, how did the Mabo case change history? Here's your final clue. Taking off around the country.
It was the basis for native title claims to be made throughout the rest of Australia. It was a sort of legal precedent for recognition of common law ownership of Aboriginal people prior to Europeans.
Well done. 10 points, Emily and Andrew. Let me just take this opportunity to send a big thank you to Doug Passy from Murray Island, who went to a lot of trouble to get us this picture, and a big hello to all the Merriam people. In that round, Emily and Andrew, you picked up 20 points, and Glenda and Tony also picked up 20 points. Well done. Time for a quick break, but plate du jour is coming up, so let's head over to the kitchen. You at home can see what Ancient Friendly has whipped up for our panel tonight.
Tonight I'm preparing a traditional Chinese dish. Bean sprouts with braised chicken testicles. Well, they're rooster's testicles to be precise. I've already skinned and boiled the testicles. Then I've added some stock, some carrots, some mushrooms, some salt, spices and sauces, just to make it taste nice. I'm going to make a little bit of a nest out of these bean sprouts, the testicles. Those boys need a little bit of padding. Delicious.
Get more fun out of your computer and play the ADBC online quiz at sbs.com.au/ADBC.
blind date.
Welcome back to ADBC. Currently, Emily and Andrew are on 30 points, and Glenda and Tony are also on 30 points. In this round, teams get to match their minds against those of bygone eras. Simple as that. Team BC, you're up first. For 10 points, let's find out if you are smarter than a first century Chinese scientist. Mm. To show when an earthquake had occurred and its approximate location, the Chinese philosopher and scientist, Zhang Hung, did the following. A, hung a pendulum that would strike the side of a giant pot and release a ball from a dragon's mouth. B, placed a flower vase on a tree branch that would fall to the ground and break. And C, launched a miniature junk lined with model soldiers that would overbalance and fall off the deck.
Well, you are going to be just flabbergasted to discover that I actually do know the answer to this one. I bizarrely...
Are we leaving it to you?
I think I know the answer, but let's just... Because often it's a trick question here, so let's go through. Somebody's launching a miniature boat. That's just idiotic, even for this program. The flower vase on a tree branch that will fall to the ground and break. Well, it's ingenious. You've got to give him points for that. But I think it is actually number one. He invented something. It was like a giant lotto ball machine, basically, that dropped balls into, I thought it was frogs' mouths, and then they would go to the panel of three adjudicators from Tattersalls and they would say, yes, earthquake, we'll pay that one. But Glenda, it was. I'm pretty sure that that
how
was...
How is this sounding to you, Glenda?
Well, first I thought I'd like to ring a friend, actually, about this one. But the more I think about it, I think Tony's right, because I think in the first one what you've got is some notion of vibration going with the pendulum swinging. And... Well, the other two, it's a little bit more arbitrary about why they'd fall off. I mean, what's going to cause the soldiers falling off or the...
And let's go over, let's cross now to the earthquake centre, and it's a bloke bar, tree branch, thing happening so far.
I can tell that the answer is A.
Yes!
Earthquake.
That's right, it went into it, it dropped from the dragon's mouth into its mouth.
That says earthquake to me.
Vase? And it had a pendulum in it, and when there was a vibration, like you said, which is the best way to detect of an earthquake, apparently, tremors from that would cause the pendulum to strike out in a certain direction. Whatever ball fell from that dragon's mouth, that is the direction from where the earthquake was coming. Team AD, your turn. 10 points. Are you smarter than a BC party planner?
Hazard a guess at yes, but that's cocky.
Question is, in order to be able to predict the future date of lunar cycles and eclipses to create calendars and plan religious festivals, the ancient Greeks used A, an ancient version of the sextant to measure the position of the stars in relation to the horizon, B, an obelisk drilled with an array of holes through which stars and planets could be viewed, or C, a mechanical calculator with moving mechanisms, wheels, gears representing the planets.
I actually think they, A and B, look much more credible than C, but I think there was actually a very early form of... it's even been referred to as a computer that was, as a sort of predecessor to the computer that was a mechanism with moving parts.
So I think it might be C. I mean, I was thinking B, the obelisk, but then I realised I've only ever seen obelisks in Asterix, in Gaul.
And that was much later, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. No, there was 50 BC and you need magic potions to move them, so...
Anytime Asterix comes up, it's always a good show. He cannot fail.
I think we should go with C because it's so unlikely and, in my experience, it's the unlikeliest answer.
Mechanical calculator. So, let's go with C.
I will tell you that the answer is C. A mechanical calculator with moving mechanisms, wheels and gears. 10 points.
Spiro, come on, let's go to the party now, quick! Oh, nice watch.
Glenda.
I've seen it in a museum in Athens.
You're going to say in cash converters.
No. It's the Antikythera mechanism.
It is, and what did it do?
Well, it worked much as it was described there. It had cogs and wheels and it was meant to emulate the movement of the planets. But they've only recently been able to find that out because they've used... I mean, there's only a fragment of the actual computer that's...
Remaining.
..around. It was salvaged from the bottom of the sea. And they've used X-rays in order to see inside this fragment and to understand how it might have worked. But there's still some controversy over exactly how it did work. It's an amazing thing to see.
It's totally incompatible with the printer that they supply to go with it.
Emily and Andrew, and Glenda and Tony, you also picked up 10 points. Well done. Time now to combine food and history. Tonight, Friendy has delved into his ancient cookbook to get a meal in accordance with a recipe of long ago. Friendy, what's on the menu tonight?
I've got to give you a little warning there, Sammy. This one may contain traces of nuts.
Tone, is that too cryptic for you?
I think we know where this is heading.
Question one is the key ingredient. What is the key ingredient? That is what I'm after.
The key ingredient is hate.
Yeah. Oh, I think there's a hint of disappointment in there.
I'll give you some tips. Cowboy caviar.
Cowboy caviar.
Oh!
Montana tendergroins.
Prairie oyster. No, you know what? It's cow's testicles.
It's not a cow's testicles, it's a smaller animal.
Yeah, I think so.
It's from a footballer.
With, with feathers.
The only feathered animal that comes to mind, it's a chicken.
I'm going to pay it. It's a rooster. Rooster testicles. Ooh. Is what you are. And that's cutlery down for Tone, it would seem.
I knew Friendy would get round to testicles eventually.
This is a very, very old recipe.
Have they done this one on MasterChef yet?
James, what else is in it? Go around the rooster testicles and tell us what else.
That looks like seaweed to me.
Seaweed?
Yeah.
Or a fungus? Like a mushroomy thing?
Oh, it could be.
Yeah, no, that, you're right. There's black mushrooms in it. Sliced carrot, Tone mentioned. There's sesame oil. There's chicken fat. Mm. There's lard, stock, wine, salt and pepper to taste, Friendy?
To taste.
And soy sauce. Question two. Can anyone tell me the country of origin and date this dish? Glenda.
Oh, and date. Well, bean sprout soy sauce has got to be Chinese.
Yes, half right.
Date. You go for it, Tony.
I can see it's very old, Tony.
The 3rd of June, 1975. Just take a stab.
It's very old. It's very old.
It's very old.
The first Christmas.
I'm going to give you 5 points for that. It's 1132 AD. It's an ancient dish. And the Chinese considered testicles...
delicious.
Yes. What did they think that testicles did for you?
Well, I'm guessing they're a bit of a fertility booster for men than for women. So I'd go with an increaser for virility.
The Chinese thought that it was actually an aphrodisiac, but the Greeks thought it was fertility.
OK.
Glenda and Tony, in that round you picked up 15 points, and Andrew and Emily, you picked up 20 points. Well done. As always, a big thank you to our resident chef, Friendy, for that beautiful dish. Thank you, Friendy. This is ADBC, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to ADBC, where scores are currently the AD team of Emily and Andrew on 60 points, the BC team of Glenda and Tony not far behind on 55 points. Wow. Teams are shown a symbol and then asked about its historical and modern-day significance. So here it is.
Oh.
Question one is, what is this symbol and what do we associate it with? Andrew.
Jolly Roger Pirates.
That is correct. 10 yeah. points. Well done. Yeah. Question two. Where did the term Jolly Roger originate? Glenda.
It's originally a French term. Oh, this is one theory about it, right? Because pirates used to fly red flags and they were called pretty red, Jolly Rouge. So, and that was the derivative of the Jolly Roger, Jolly Rouge.
10 points. Well done.
Yes.
Question three. Where does the skull and crossbones flag originate? Andrew.
I think one theory I've heard is from there used to be a skull and crossbones on the cross, the Christian cross. They used to put a skull and crossbones under Jesus' feet, which meant that Jesus had won over death. And essentially it indicated death, you know, but it came from the Christian crucifix.
Yes, that is correct. 10 points. Emily and Andrew, you picked up 20 points in that round, and Glenda and Tony, you picked up 10 points. Well done. Teams buzz in and tell me whether the following eight statements are fact or are they fiction. Question one. Albert Einstein was offered the presidency of Israel in 1952 when he was 73 years old, but declined. Fact or fiction? Glenda.
Fact.
That is a fact. He wasn't ready. He wanted to live a little first. Question two. During World War II, the language of the Aztec Indians was used by Allied forces to encode messages. Andrew.
Fiction. It was the language of a different Indian tribe.
That is correct. Fiction. It was the Navajo Indians. The Japanese considered it an unbreakable code. Question three. There is evidence that ice invented in Finland over 5,000 years ago with bones used as skates. Fact or fiction?
Fiction.
Fact.
Really? Bones? What bones?
Humans.
Really? That works for skates, does it?
If you didn't have your own bones, you could hire bones at the rink. Question four. Dominic Leroy, Napoleon's chief surgeon, could amputate an arm in 17 seconds. Fact or fiction? Emily.
Fiction.
Faction.
I'm going to say fiction.
Yeah, sure, fiction.
Fact.
Oh.
And he could amputate a leg in 1 minute. Question five. Vincent van Gogh never sold a single painting during his lifetime. Glenda.
Fact.
That is fiction. He sold one.
One.
To his brother?
Red Vineyards at Arles. Question six. The term Siamese twins was based on a famous pair of Thai conjoined twin brothers who lived in the 19th century. Glenda.
Fact.
That is a fact. Chang and Eng Bunker toured the world as an exhibit of curiosity before settling down in America. Question seven. Among the various methods of human sacrifice in Mesoamerican civilizations was the Aztec custom of ripping out the victim's still beating heart and holding it up to the sky to honour the sun god. Glenda.
Fact.
It's fiction. It's from Indiana Jones.
You're both right. It's fact and it's from Indiana Jones.
Oh, really?
Well, it's fact. It's fact. And it was in Indiana Jones. Kalima! Question eight. Buzz Aldrin was the first man in history to urinate on the moon. Fact or fiction?
Fact!
It is a fact. He used his relief tube on TV with 1/5 of the world watching. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. There we go. So that's the end of the show. Glenda and Tony, you picked up 95 points tonight, but tonight's winners are Emily and Andrew on 100 points.
Close. I think it's wonderful that it was the whizzing in space fact that got us over the line.
We'd like to thank the AD team, Dr. Emily Booth and Andrew McClelland. And also the BC team, Professor Glenda Sluger and Tony Martin. Thanks for watching ADBC. And remember, those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. With that in mind, we'll be back next week to do it all over again. My name was Sam Pang. Good night.